Thanks very much, and thank you to everyone for the invitation to speak. This is a slightly different style of talk from what we've been having this morning, not least because there's a number of graphs and numbers thrown in there, so I apologise for that, but hopefully it will draw on aspects which we've heard from Sullivan earlier on and be a good introduction to the next two speakers. So to put the climate change issue into context and so that we're all on the same page for this, all of the politicians around the world have agreed on this 2 degrees level of climate change, level of global warming, which is the threshold which shouldn't be exceeded at any stage between now and forever. Some countries have signed up to 1.5 degrees level, obviously more stringent than the 2 degrees level, but everyone's agreed to the 2 degrees level. So here, whenever I talk about avoiding climate change or mitigating climate change, I'm referring to that. And also recent climate science has shown that the level of global warming we can expect in the future is very closely related to the cumulative level of emissions that there are overall time. So this has given rise to the idea that there is a certain carbon budget, a certain level, cumulative level of emissions which can occur from now going out into the future, which gives us a reasonable chance of staying below the 2 degrees level. And this number depends on how confident you want to be about staying below 2 degrees and on various other assumptions you make. But broadly speaking, it's around about the 1.1 gigaton level of emissions. Sorry, 1,100 gigatons of carbon dioxide. And this range is shown in the green bar there on the graph on the bottom left-hand side. And people have known about this idea of a carbon budget for a while now, and they've compared this to the total cumulative level of emissions that would result if we were to burn all the fossil fuels that are known to exist. So there's, first of all, there's fossil fuel reserves, which are those quantities which people expect to be produced. They have quite a strict definition, but broadly speaking, they are the volumes which have a certain probability of being produced and are economically and technically currently extractable. And then you also have a much broader resource base, fossil fuel resource base. These are things, volumes which haven't been discovered yet or which might require future technological developments to bring online. So if we compare the green bar to the dark brown bar, the dark brown bars there are the levels of emissions that result if we burn all the fossil fuel reserves, and the slightly lighter colour is if we burnt all of the fossil fuel resources that are estimated to exist. And there's quite clearly a big disparity between those the levels of those bars. And so people have known that, again, for a while and said that, well, broadly speaking, if we burn all of the fossil fuel reserves that are known to exist, this would exceed the 2 degrees carbon budget by around 3 times. And what that they've more or less then said to date and how the conversation has been going is therefore two-thirds of the fossil fuels need to stay in the ground, and we can afford to burn one-third of our existing reserve levels. What we wanted to do in the paper which we had published in January was really differentiate between these fuels, and I think this feeds into some of the discussion which we'll be having. So that because we know that the different fossil fuels are very different in their characteristics, oil is a lot more energy dense than gas and coal, and is therefore more useful for transport. Coal is much more dirty than the other two, and gas is the cleanest of the three fossil fuels. We want to try and differentiate between the different levels of fossil fuels, and so how much of each of these fossil fuels do we use if we want to avoid dangerous climate change? And we can go one step level further than that by using a model which we have in the institute, which can give a geographical representation of these fossil fuels. It can say who owns the levels of oil reserves, gas reserves, coal reserves, and also of the fossil resources if we want to stay within the 2 degrees carbon budget. So we don't want to spend too long discussing the model, but to have any sort of confidence in the results or the implications, we need to understand a little bit of how the model itself is set up. So I'll try to go through this as quickly as possible. So the model we have in the institute is called TMUCL. TM stands for Times Integrated Assessment Model. And this splits the world up into 16 different regions shown in the map. So all of the major emitters and major consumers of energy are separately characterized. So China is a separate region, India, the US, Canada, etc. And within each of these regions, the way the model operates is it starts by estimating the level of energy service demands that currently exist and will exist between now and 2100. So energy service demands are things like tons of steel will be produced, or billion vehicles per kilometre will be driven, or how much we'll be heating our homes in the future. And it estimates how much of all of these different service demands will exist, given GDP and population assumptions. and it separates the senator service amount into a number of sectors at the bottom, which you probably can't see, but the ones in red, so the industrial sector, the transport sector, agricultural sector, commercial and residential, all have different levels of service demands in each of the 16 regions. And modelling has a variety of options of satisfying these service demands given the primary energy sources that are available. So there's the traditional fossil fuels, the coal and gas, which are at the top there in blue. They can be transformed into useful energy vectors such as electricity or diesel or gasoline, etc. And there's also the alternatives like nuclear, bioenergy, renewables, which can also be transformed into things like electricity and hydrogen as well. And the way the model operates is it finds the cheapest way, the cost optimal way of satisfying all of these energy service demands given the primary energy sources that are available and given the different technologies that are available. So there's a very large number of technologies in here. So in the transport sector, you have the energy service demand might be passenger vehicles, people driving their cars, and the model has options of gasoline, diesel, natural gas, plug-in hybrids, hybrids, electric vehicles, hydrogen vehicles. All of these different technologies are characterized within the model. And as down the side of there, we can see the climate module, which takes the levels of emissions which result from any of the given trajectories of the use of fossil fuels going forward and converts this into a temperature rise. And that's important in this piece of work because you can use that climate module to put a cap on the temperature rise which occurs in the future. So if we put on a 2 degrees cap, the model will find the cost optimal way of satisfying all of the energy service demands, making sure that the lights are kept on, so to speak, while ensuring that also the temperature rise doesn't go above 2 degrees. So just to mention, because I will come back to this later on, that to characterize the fossil fuel resource and reserve based on the model is quite a difficult task, but we spent quite a long time going through all the different types of oil, types of gas and types of coal that exist, such as reserves, such as undiscovered, such as reserve growth, such as oil and gas which might exist in the Arctic regions, such as the tar sands in Canada, the extra heavy oil in Venezuela, and so on and so forth, and characterize the resource potential and the costs for all of these different volumes of fossil fuels. And that's captured by the supply curves there. So coming on to the results of this, so if we want this reasonable chance of staying below 2 degrees, the model will give you the optimal distribution of using fossil fuels between now and 2050. So what we have here is the level of reserves which are used for oil, gas, and coal within each of the different regions in the model. And in percentage terms, what this says on a global level, for example, is that 82% of existing coal reserves have to not be used before 2050 under this 2 degree scenario. Similarly, half of the gas has to stay in the ground and a third of oil reserves. But we can also see that these are very much not spread evenly around the world. So if we look at coal, for example, we can see that the United States and Russia, which hold absolutely huge volumes of coal reserves, use less than 5% of their existing reserve base before by 2050. And that means that 95% of their coal reserves in those two regions has to stay on the ground. Similarly, if we look at oil, for example, look at the Middle East holds 260 billion barrels of oil, which have to stay on the ground. 260 billion barrels, broadly speaking, equivalent to all of the reserves currently held by Saudi Arabia. So it would be like saying, if we just stop all production from Saudi Arabia, put all of their oil in the ground, then the Middle East has done its job. But obviously that's not a typically feasible way of going about things. And another one just to point out is Canada. Canada, we can see, is the least has the least utilization of its reserves, has the highest level of its unburnable reserves, up at around 75%. And that's partly, as we'll come back to, because of the oil sands and the tar sands which it possesses. And on the gas, the picture is similar, that the Middle East holds an absolutely huge volume. 46 trillion cubic meters of gas is an absolutely massive amount. We currently use globally around just over 3 trillion cubic meters a year. So the Middle East sacrificing 46 trillion cubic meters is obviously a fairly big hit on what it expects. But these are reserve numbers, which are volumes which people expect to be produced in a reasonable time frame, which is around about 30 years. So one of the things which we didn't include in the paper itself, but which we asked about quite a bit subsequently, and also which I think is quite important for the conversation we'll be having, is to compare what happens between this optimal 2 degree scenario and one which is more like a business as usual case. Business as usual more or less means that we will head out towards 4 or 5 degrees by the end of the century, and that's the scenario which is shown in black there, and the 2 degrees one is shown in green. And we can can see, for example, that for coal, under the 2-degree scenario, there's an absolute drop-off in levels of coal production, coal consumption going forward. So it rises up to about 2015, 2020, and then actually just drops off a cliff. Whereas in the 5-degree scenario, it continues to rise out over the course of the model horizon. On the other side, it's also, we can see quite a large gap between the two. The gap between those two scenarios is around about 220 billion barrels of oil, so the cumulative level of differences between these two is again around about, probably speaking, the level of reserves held by Saudi Arabia. But it's important to note that graph on the left-hand side doesn't go down to zero. So actually, levels of oil consumption bump along, probably speaking, at current levels. And on gas, we can see a kind of completely different way in which the model reacts. Because you have this very, very rapid reduction in coal consumption, that means that actually, in the short to medium term, the only thing that can step into that, into the breach left by this drop-off in coal, is gas. Obviously, renewables come through, nuclear, energy efficiency, and so on and so forth, but to really manage to keep satisfying energy service demands while having this massive reduction in coal, you see a larger uptake in gas consumption in a 2-degree scenario than you see in the kind of a more steady rise in the 5-degree scenario. Saying that the consumption in the 2-degree scenario then flattens off, and that's why you will hear many companies often talking about gas as a transition fuel or gas acting as a bridge towards a low carbon future. And that's very much what these results are suggesting needs to happen and is the optimal thing to happen from a global perspective. And the other thing that this really demonstrates to us is that it's not particularly fair to talk about fossil fuels all as a collective. Coal has a completely different pitch from oil, which has a completely different pitch from gas. So coal, we can see, has to just completely disappear. So if you're a pure coal company, it's going to be pretty difficult for you to maintain your industry going forward. If you're an oil company, we can see, for example, there is still a continuous level of consumption. So there will be required to be some oil consumed up to 2015, but there's no growth. Whereas gas, for example, is really kind of the big growth industry out to about 2035 before it starts to flatten off. So you really talk about the fossil fuels separately if we're to have a conversation on how you engage with different fossil fuel companies. And three more kind of specific results which came out from our paper, which are worth mentioning. I talked about the fact that we separately characterize resources in the Arctic. There is a huge amount of undiscovered, potentially a huge amount of oil and gas in the Arctic, which has yet to be discovered. And this is separately characterized in the model. But under the 2-degree scenario, we don't see any of that produced before 2050. Whereas we do see it produced under that 5-degree scenario. And what that suggests is that oil and gas in the Arctic is unburnable. It's not required under a 2-degree future. Another thing to mention is that the fossil fuel companies often talk about using carbon capture and storage as a magic bullet to, if we can get carbon capture and storage correct, we can burn all of our fossil fuel reserves. Everything is fine because it's CCS solves all our problems. So what I wanted to do was see, is that actually the case? And so we compared two scenarios here. One, we've just been talking about, the 2-degree scenarios with CCS, these are the headline figures in the box there, versus a scenario which doesn't allow carbon capture and storage to be implemented on any electrical or industrial process. And we can see the difference between the two scenarios. So in coal, increases by around, the usage of coal when you have CCS increases by around about 6 percentage points, whereas the oil and gas is much lower, about 1 or 2% greater that you can use if you get CCS right. And what this really shows is this kind of puts a bit of a dampener on whether CCS really can be a massive help in developing greater levels of fossil fuels between now and 2050. There's a number of reasons for this, not least that carbon capture and storage can't capture all of the emissions. So coal, being such a dirty fuel, CCS can capture 90% of those emissions, but those 10% of emissions become really important, especially if you want to have a decarbonized global low carbon economy or energy system. Similarly, CCS is currently not a proven technology. There was a plant constructed in Canada opened last year that was absolutely astronomically expensive and really showed that actually CCS is not yet deployable on a commercial basis. So we assume that CCS can become deployed in around 2025, but then the market for that has to mature over time. Once you have a new technology coming through, it's not as if you can immediately apply CCS to every single coal or gas power plant that opens up. Therefore, there's a time while the market for CCS matures, and because of this late data introduction and because of the time to maturity, actually CCS doesn't make a huge difference between now and 2050. And the final thing to mention is on the Canadian wood sands, which we often hear about which are the most energy intensive form of oil to produce around the world. And that's because the oil is incredibly low quality, and to extract it, one of the key ways is to pump heat down into the ground to melt the oil so that it flows to the surface more easily. And at present, all of that heat is generated by using natural gas because of the shale gas boom in North America. Gas is very cheap, so obviously the cheapest way of producing that heat is through natural gas. So that's what's shown on the right-hand graph here, is the different colours of bars show the fuel type used to generate this heat. And you can see that gas is predominantly there in 2010 and 2015. But then under this 2 degrees now, you see a very rapid shift from gas into lower carbon forms of heat generation. So basically it's using bioenergy here, and actually towards the end of the modeling period, it uses bioenergy for CCS. So you're actually getting negative emission heat. And if it's possible for Canada to do this, have this complete rapid reduction in the carbon intensity of producing a barrel of oil from the tar sands, it is possible for there to be some level of production of the oil sands, but only if this happens. And we can see, for example, that by 2020, 2025, this heat has to be carbon neutral. It has to be completely balanced. Any gas used has to be balanced by a use of bioenergy and CCS. And this is completely different from any of the projections you see for the Canadian oil companies on the carbon intensity of heat they'll be producing. So this is a really very, very optimistic assumption on how Canada will generate its oil. Future. And even if it does do this, the levels of consumption fall between now and 2050, and they certainly don't rise, as we see. So really this is painting a bad picture for the prospect of oil sands under a 2 degrees future. So I will finish with just a few thoughts on what a lot of this means. There's two points on the political side of things, and 2 points on the more investor side of things, or the companies themselves, but it's actually the fossil fuel industry quite hard to separate between these two things, given that state-owned companies state-owned companies effectively own around about 80% of the oil reserves around the world. If you want to leave some of this oil and gas in the ground, you're going to have to engage with those state-owned companies, which means engaging with the countries themselves. And so it's worth mentioning, reiterating again, that every country signed up to this 2 degrees limit. Yet at the same time, every single country wants to develop its own fossil fuel reserves. And even more so, they want to keep looking for and developing new sources of fossil fuels going into the future. So there's a real disconnect there between what they're pledging on one hand and what they're actually doing. UK shale gas would be a good example of this. Is UK shale gas really a required new resource to develop if we're going moving towards a low carbon economy? The other thing to mention on the political side of things is that the way the model is set up is that it assumes there's a global agreement. Everyone works together towards 2 degrees, and everyone works in the most cost-optimal way towards 2 degrees. That's clearly a very optimistic assumption on how the world operates, and it's clearly a wrong assumption on how the world operates, but it's a basis on which you can then have the conversation on, well, if you don't want to work out optimally, how do you want to operate going forward? And one of the key aspects of the climate change negotiations, which are completely overlooked by this analysis, is how do you apportion historical responsibility for emissions in the past? Because developed countries have benefited from 100-odd years of industrial development through the use of fossil fuels, should the developing countries or lower-income countries be allowed to emit more, so that developed countries have to consume even less carbon? And that is that if they want to consume more carbon, they may want to also develop some of their fossil fuels. As because all the countries want to develop their fossil fuel reserves, it's clear that it's quite a profitable thing to do. So should developing countries be allowed to develop more of their reserves than developed countries? But actually, in the engagement we've had since the paper came out, it's the exact opposite that you're seeing. A lot of the large fossil fuel producers, particularly Canada and Australia, when engaging with us on this, have said, well, actually, they're picking on us. You know, we can produce more of our tar sands, Australia can produce more of its coal, and still stay within 2 degrees. And that's of course correct. Canada could produce all of its oil sands if it wanted to, and we wouldn't exceed 2 degrees. But if it produces all of its oil sands, that means so much more of the cheaper and better used fossil fuels would have to be in the ground as a result, and the world would lose as a result. It would be good for Canada, it would be bad for everyone else. So this is clearly a political decision which needs to be taken into account when people are deciding on who's going to suffer or who's going to lose out as a result of climate change. And just to mention on engaging with the companies themselves, companies clearly are looking for and developing new sources of fossil fuels, and if we've seen that a large portion of the existing reserves can't be used, is it really justified that we continue to explore and develop new sources? And on the investor side, who obviously own all of these companies, should they be asking these companies, could this money be better used, better employed, rather than you exploring for, let's say, resources in the Arctic, which is a risky business as it is, but even if you do discover stuff, and then there's an agreement to work towards 2 degrees, might never actually be banned, never be produced. Therefore, is there a better way of kind of returning value to shareholders other than